Hello and welcome to this edition of Journalist Hangout. I am Esther Omopariola. On today's program, we'll continue with our retrospect in 2020 in retrospect and projections into the year 2021. I am joined by Babajide Kolade Otitoju and Adewale Adeoye. Welcome to the show, gentlemen. Journalist Hangout starts now. Now, the year 2020 is a year Nigerians and indeed the world will not forget in a hurry. Nigerian students sat at home for 9 months, and while this academic staff union of universities embarked on a year-long strike, placing demands, negotiating terms and agreements before the federal government. Now, Babajide, 2020 definitely has been a year of strike and protests from ASU to the doctor's strike. Now, what should we expect this time around? The government appears to well have yielded to ASU's demands, and how do we ensure industrial harmony in our institutions?
Well, I don't know whether to agree with you that government has yielded to ASU's demands. What ASU has done is simply to suspend the strike. And they were very careful not to call it off. There's a difference between suspending a strike and calling it off, because they know that in relating with the employer, if you are to call a strike, you need to give the employer some days of grace. That's what the labor laws say. You can't suddenly start a strike. But by suspending it, what they've simply done is to give themselves the opportunity to resume the strike at any time without any notice. So, and what was agreed was that in December, before the end of December, government will pay the December salary and 2 months of outstanding salary. That has not been done. As we speak, that has not been done. So if you got into a negotiation with your employer and certain agreements were reached which are meant to encourage you to end the strike, and there are timelines, and those timelines are, as we speak, not conformed with. It's like sowing the seed for a fresh strike. What government needs to do is to conform with the first agreement that it has reached with ASU, implement the agreements reached. If you agree that you are going to pay those salaries before the end of the, December. We're already in January now. ASU has not reported that such payments have happened. I have fears about industrial harmony in our tertiary institutions, because as we can see now, even the non-academic staff, they've already served a notice to government that they too will embark on a strike. Having seen how there's a form of rivalry now that is going on between what is supposed to be a support services to academic staff, now leveraging on ASU's endless strike to start a strike of their own, or to attempt to start a strike of their own. That is what we are seeing. The only way that we can be sure that there will not be this form of endless strike, long strike, that we saw last year, is for all the parties to conform with the agreements reached. Once that happens, everyone knows that yes, then there will be peace. The issue of end academic allowances, 40 billion, there is already some form of misunderstanding about the sharing formula for that money. I said it some time ago that if it is called end academic allowance, then it's supposed to be meant for the academic staff alone because of that critical word, academic. But government broached the idea of also accommodating the non-academic staff who also have their own demands or their own grievances out of the money. But we are seeing now from some of these press statements that have been issued that those guys too are already paying for blood, in inverted commas. So it sends a very bad signal. And what I don't want to see is a situation in which after all of these months of the children or the students staying at home, we are seeing signs that the suspended strike may actually be resumed because it was not called off. People must bear that in mind. They carefully chose their words that we are suspending the strike, not calling it off. Because once it's suspended, then they reserve the right
to resume
the strike without serving a notice to the federal government as demanded by labor laws. So this is the situation that we found ourselves.
Adewale, from the point that Babajide has given, clearly there is yet to be a finality in ASUU strikes in our country today. But given what has happened over the year, the past year, and in 2021, do you see a possibility of another ASUU strike?
If you look at it, there are two opinions. There are those who feel worried that the strike, you know, has been overstretched. Students are staying home for too long, and that ASUU should sympathize with the students. But if you take a critical look, you know, on the demands being made by ASUU, I think there are very fundamental issues that are being raised. In fact, it's strange. If you look at almost every union, NANS, NLC, people can easily accuse them of being tied to the approach string of the federal government. It is only strange that even us, I mean, you still have a union that can stand on principle, making demands, and you know, not allow itself to be bought over by vested political interest. So if you look at the demands that they are making, talking about university revitalization, if you go to the universities, so universities built in the 60s, when you compare them with their peers, even in Ghana, you will know that we are nowhere, that there is, you know, the universities are declining. They also call for visitor panel to be set up by the federal government. They call for a stop to proliferation of state universities, you know, among many other demands, and that the funding for education should go up. But this year, when the budget was being prepared, only about 5.6% was allocated to education, which almost the lowest in the past one decade. Compared with what UNESCO recommends, you know, between 15 to 20%. So I think if you look at the demands being made for ASUU, I think they are basic demands that I think they are in the interest of Nigeria. If you look at the police budget, it's still far more than what we have budgeted for education, defense budget. And it's better for you to invest in education so as to prevent conflict, to prevent instability. So the last meeting they had, they said by December 6, ASUU will resume. Then December 9, then the federal government will have met its own obligations. But by December 9, the federal government met those obligations only on paper by saying that we have released 70 billion, 40 billion for and academic allowances, and then 30 billion for university revitalization. But in practical terms, that money is just is a myth, it's a dream. So I think from what I'm saying, ASUU needs to insist, whatever is going to be the cost, the implication, if we are really interested in the future of education in this country, I think this year, unless the federal government lives up to expectation, we may continue to see another chain of crisis and, you know, and the rest here.
Well, with that being said, perhaps the most impactful event of 2020 remains the outbreak of coronavirus pandemic and how Nigeria had its share of the challenges of containing the spread and treatment. Notable deaths this year was due to complications from COVID-19 from Abba Kyari, the former chief of staff to the president of to Major General Erefin of the Nigerian Army. Now, Babajide, we understand 2020 indeed was a year of COVID-19. There were rising cases in Nigeria, and right now we have set another record yesterday, which is about 1,204 cases. So what do you think we can do, or the country rather, can do to bring COVID-19 under control?
I think first and foremost, people must stop deceiving themselves that COVID-19 does not exist. I've heard people say repeatedly that it's just malaria in another form. But if it's malaria in another form, how come in countries of the world where malaria is non-existent? Because there are countries in this world where malaria does not exist. It's not one of the diseases that trouble them. How come they have COVID? You know? So how come they have COVID? And when you suffer from malaria, for example, the losing your sense of smell is not one of the symptoms of malaria. There are some symptoms of COVID-19 that are not consistent with the symptoms of malaria. So we need to stop deceiving ourselves that this COVID-19 does not exist, that it's just an attempt by government to make money off people. In fact, one apparently, I can't find the word to describe him, maybe I should just spare him this time, on Facebook was asking me how much I had been paid. He said, there are people who want to steal money through COVID-19 and you are their mouthpiece. So he was asking me how much I had been paid. Of course, I didn't hesitate. I sent the person to the block industry that my younger sister runs. That is the best treatment for such people. When you come to another person's wall to spew absolute rubbish on social media, that person reserves the right to send you to Blockville. And that was what I did. There is a deliberate attempt on the part of some Nigerians, including educated people. Because you can't simply say, oh, this is just the rantings of illiterates. Some educated people have taken it upon themselves to misdirect and miseducate the rest of our people on this disease. And even in rural areas, it's killing people. But people give the impression that, oh, it only kills the rich, it only kills the prominent people in society. The reason you hear that it has killed those prominent people is because they are prominent, they are newsmakers. When the ordinary man dies, it is not news. Nobody will publish the story because the ordinary man will not sell newspapers and will not attract eyeballs on TV. So this is what our people fail to realize. They say, oh, it's only the rich people that it kills. But those rich people, a lot of them have got the resources to even pay for an entire hospital. Yet, COVID-19 has taken their lives. That's the reason our people should take those protocols that the PTF has come up with seriously. And it's not expensive. It's not expensive to take hygiene seriously. It's not. The alternative is dangerous. Our people need to realize that. Our people need to realize that. Look at the UK. Look at what it's doing to them. Look at what it's doing to them. Very soon now, in UK, about 100,000 people will have died. Because the last time I checked, it's already moving close to that. And the cases are rising. The government is worried. The government has instituted another round lockdown. If you in England now, if you do not have a very cogent reason to be on the streets, you have to be within the four walls of your home. That is how serious it is. And there are variants of it, different strains of it now. They are talking about the South Africa strain, they are talking about the UK strain, even Nigeria strain of it. And they are saying that there is even no evidence that the vaccines, these vaccines that they've come up with, can tackle some of the new strains. That is where I'm worried. That humanity, we are in dire straits. Ask anyone who has survived COVID. Just tell him to tell his the story. Story to you. It's not a laughing matter at all. Mm-hmm. But because it has not reached the door of some people, they are believing that it does not exist. No. It's not something that we should take lightly at all. And our people, government must also step up enlightenment and be ready to enforce. The Kaduna State Governor, when he came up with those measures, I gave him all the support, as I always do. Because he's trying his best to save the lives of his people. Mm. But our people must also help government. We are quick to abuse government, to say they are irresponsible, to say they steal all the money. But we need to search our hearts. Are we behaving like good people when we, on our own, sabotage even measures that are meant to help save lives? Just ask if all the hospitals that government has designated as treatment centers, whether in Abuja or Lagos, they are bursting at the seams with patients. There was even one that they had to keep people outside because all the beds are already occupied. People don't know, many people don't know the extent of the problem that we are facing. So they can sit on social media and say, no, this thing is rubbish, it does not exist, it's a conspiracy to steal money. Oh, definitely it's not. It's a global problem. And we in Nigeria cannot be different from the rest of the world. Look at the measures that the Saudis have taken, for example. Mm-hmm. Are you going to say the Saudis don't want to make money? You know how much money comes into Saudi Arabia in a Hajj year? Every year, when people come for pilgrimage. But they had to stop it. They are not fools. They just had to do what's right. See the way it's killing people in California. It's an emergency. We have to see it as such. Just as government said in the past, we have to take responsibility as individuals. We have to tell ourselves that we will do whatever is right to protect ourselves. This is not a time to get reckless. It's not a time.
Indeed. Mm. So from the point that BK has raised, we need to take up our responsibility. We should take this responsibility solely if we have to battle COVID-19, you know, as the case may be. But will the vaccines, Adewale, address the problem? Because already we have BioNTech, Pfizer's BioNTech. We have AstraZeneca. And we have others that are also coming on stream. Yeah. So what do you think the vaccines will solve the problem even while we have this new variant?
The vaccines, there's no ailment that vaccine will automatically solve the problems. But the idea is to realize that it's a step forward. It's not a step backward. But vaccine alone is not enough to stop the problem. Prevention is always better than cure. And that's why I'm worried by the level of ignorance. Like Babagide said, even among educated people, you know, you see people coming up to say this thing is not real and all that, that they want to use it to make money. Now, there is a point you need to make, and then when you want to prove the argument, it doesn't make sense. How do people use COVID-19 to make money? When people are closing down their shops, they are losing a lot of funds. You know, governments are closing down travel agencies, airports. The governments will lose a lot of money. Saudi Arabia is closing down pilgrimage. Saudi Arabia will lose a lot of money. So how do you now tell me that they are using it to make money? And if you look at it, this is something that has united every country, irrespective of ideological divide. Iran and America, they are speaking the same voice on COVID-19. Saudi Arabia and Syria, they are speaking the same language. Southern Sudan, Northern Sudan, they are speaking the same language on COVID-19. So I don't think 200 countries all over the world, more than 200 countries all over the world, will be fooling themselves. Right. So I think we have enough evidence to be very cautious. The figures, they used to be figures, but they are now turning to names of people that we know, people very close to us. You know, so we need to take precaution. Like, government cannot put a knife on your neck to say, okay, put on, even where you can do it on the street, but what of when you get home? If you don't even like yourself, think of your children or your neighbor. So I think we need to take precautions. And I think the rule should be that prevention is better than cure. Let's take precautions so that we can prevent the situation where it will be ever aggravated, especially in a country where the air service is very poor.
Right. Now, with that being said, now, there had been protests in Nigeria before October 2020, but the NSAS protests, which rocked the country later in the year, will go down in history, a peaceful protest by concerned citizens to protest against police brutality, extrajudicial killings, and other forms of abuses. Air was hijacked and mayhem was unleashed, causing deaths, destruction of public infrastructure, and looting of businesses. Now, BKO, definitely we were around when all these things happened, especially to TVC News, where we had a fallout of the protests. But, you know, what lessons do you think we can learn about the NSAS protests, which ravaged part of the country last year?
First and foremost, I think the police have to learn an exemplary lesson. If a unit of the police known as SAS had not been as notorious as it was for taking people's lives cheaply, there would have been no need for that protest. There would have been no need. Many of us who supported the protest, it was because we felt it was right for government to do something about extrajudicial killings by the police. This has nothing to do with how it then got hijacked. You know, dishonest people, propagandists, professional propagandists, are lumping the two faces of the protest together. The hijack of NSAS protest is a different face. Hoodlums had their own agenda. But many of us, including the vice president, saw nothing wrong in the protest. The president never saw anything wrong in protest. In his speech, he even said that their grievances were genuine. Let those professional spin doctors go back and read the president's speech. The president said that their agitation was genuine and that the government had heard them loud and clear. Why did the president say that? Because the president also said he had seen some videos of police brutality and that he found those videos shocking. So when I listened to my leaders, the president of our country, the vice president, speak in this manner, the words emanating from their mouths, they make true meaning to me. Because not just as a historian, but as a man with an eye for the spoken word, I'm taking every word that they say seriously, and I'm keen to analyze every word. So I had the VP say, Your agitation is genuine. So I have no regret that I supported the protest. There's a difference between supporting the protest and supporting the madness that happened
afterwards.
Mm-hmm. There were many of us who supported the protest and then said, look, you have stayed long enough on the roads. You have made your point clear. If people go back to some of what we said on this program, we told them that it was time to leave the streets. In fact, I suggested at a point that, look, you are making life difficult for other people. Why don't you leave like one or two lanes for people to be able to use? Other people must get to work. Other people could be in an ambulance that take them to hospital. Give them room, give the vehicles room to be able to move. Not to simply stop everyone from moving. They made mistakes in that in the course of the protest, and staying on the street for too long was one of those mistakes. Many people told them, as Rajbola met Tinubu, I remember that he addressed that issue and told them that, look, you have stayed for too long. You've made valid demands. Government came out to say, okay, we are going to set up a committee to look at the demands that you have made. If government was not taking the protest seriously, government would not have said that. And I remember that our friend Innocent Chukwuma was on one of those committees. Government chose the right people because government wanted to address that problem. They knew that extrajudicial killing was a stain on the police, and it will remain a stain until the police turns a new leaf. NSAS was meant to draw attention to that, and they succeeded in drawing attention to that. The government went ahead and disbanded SAS. That was significant. That an agency, that a unit of the police that was wasting people's lives. I remember the IG came to Lagos when they killed, when SARS killed people here. And the IG said, look, we are going to begin to use tasers. We are going to get the police to be using tasers instead of firing guns at people. And I thought that was a good move. But we didn't see that implemented. It'll be going forward. This is something that government needs to do. But the point was made, the lesson was an exemplary lesson was served by that protest, that Nigerians will not simply wink at extrajudicial killings. If some people are happy about extrajudicial killings because their family members had not been lost to extrajudicial killings, good luck to them. But a million times, some of us who talk about extrajudicial killings will kick against it. What we will not support is for clearly deranged people to then be burning BRT buses, burning TVC and other places. That's a different face. That's a different face. So lessons have been learned, and it is hoped that one of those lessons, in my view, is you don't bring in soldiers when you want to quell uprising or protests and all that. When you want to straighten up protesters, you don't bring in soldiers. We warned against it. We warned, but they didn't listen. Here, we warned. The soldiers are not trained to handle protests. They are trained to kill. If you want to find work for our soldiers, what is the Northeast for? We have not defeated Boko Haram. Mr. President admitted it in point 27 of his speech to Nigerians. So let's send them there. You don't send them after civilians who are not carrying guns. That's a lesson. That's a mistake made. And I hope that in future we will ensure that we do not repeat this kind of mistakes.
Right. Adewale, do you envisage an NSAS kind of protest in 2021, even though, or in nearest future? What are your thoughts?
To prevent a reoccurrence, we need to look back and do the right thing. The future is sometimes very difficult to predict. But because what happened last year, the NSAS protest, many of us did not expect the magnitude, especially the consequences. But I think what we should ask ourselves, have we learned enough lessons? on the part of the protesters and then on the part of the government. As far back as 2019 in September, the United Nations set up a special rapporteur who visited Nigeria, Agnes Callamard, and the focus was on extrajudicial killing. He made the recommendations to the government and warned that extrajudicial killings by SARS could spur national uprising. Yeah, it's there. This is September 2019, but we didn't listen.
So we don't listen.
Yeah, we don't care. So I think we need to learn so that we can prevent, you know, dangerous things from happening. Take adequate measures. You know, there were so many police reforms. They will tell you, okay, almost about four instances that, okay, we are going to reform the police, but nothing happened until it got to the extreme end, and then people had to take the law into their own hands. Then when you are talking about even intelligence guarding on the part of our security operatives, they were not able to foresee, you know, even if they saw it, they didn't take any action because they probably would have set up a committee to meet certain people, even though we are saying we don't know the leaders of the NSAS and all that. But some people's accounts were frozen.
Yes.
So we can't pretend as
if.
How do you identify them? So the government will have, you know, been more proactive. Meet those leaders, tell them, look, we are going to reform SARS, maybe about a month before that trial. I think this thing could have been prevented. But we take a lot of things for granted. International community will warn us, local organizations will warn us, then the government will do nothing. So I think we need to learn to listen to our people. And then the lesson is that we should not undermine the power of the people.
Absolutely.
Don't imagine that because they are keeping quiet, they are docile, you know, then you can do anything that you like. People are unpredictable.
Yes.
And when they are put to the extreme, anything can happen. And I also think we need to learn that we need to devise a means of protecting our strategic assets so that when riots get out of hand, you know, at the end of the day, the society will not be the victims again. Well, like when people start burning down, public infrastructure, institutions that are meant to promote free flow information like TV news and other people, you know, in their madness, just come and destroy such places. So we need to find out a way of protecting assets that are useful to the people themselves, like BRT buses and all that. Why do we need to burn them down? So I think it's a big lesson, and I hope we are going to take enough precautions so that this kind of thing will not happen again.
All right, and with that, let's quickly take a short break. You're still on to Journalist Hangout. We'll be back in just a moment. Stay with us. Welcome back. You're still on the Journalist Hangout, and we've been discussing 2020 in retrospect and projections in 2021. And as part of our discussions earlier, we were talking about the NSARS protests. So, Babajide, still on NSARS protests now, how about the unending controversy over the Lekki killings now? Has the president now, do you think, mandated state government to set up a panel to investigate human rights abuses? Now, do you see anything tangible coming out of this panel?
Not in all of the states. In some states, human rights abuses are minimal. All hands are not equal. That's why in some states people are calling for SARS, because the kind of bare-faced thuggery that some policemen were demonstrating because they were putting on SARS uniform, you are not seeing it in some states like Yobe, for example. Even when we are talking about prisons, you talk about a state like Yobe, you see that there are very few prisoners from Yobe. I can tell you there are very few cases of human rights abuses in Yobe. Now, compare Yobe to Rivers. Compare Yobe to Anambra. Compare Yobe to Lagos. When you set up such a panel, if you find it necessary in Yobe, they will have little or nothing to do. But when you set up that panel in Lagos, there will be tales of woe. We've read about a man that they use this plier to remove his tooth. Another man was pushed down from a story building and he became paralyzed. All kinds of wickedness by SARS, to the point that even some of our own friends in the police were saying it serves them right. This is a fact, it's not fiction. Things that they were doing. And it became an embarrassment to the force. Because the way to look at this thing is to even go back to some of what this current IG had said in the past about the same SARS. Because he too was already fed up about the excesses of SARS. The only thing was that he did not move on time to say, look, I'm fed up with you guys. I don't want to see you guys again. Maybe if he had done that, there would have been no need for the protest. You know? So I'm confident that given the seriousness with which the Lagos panel especially has demonstrated, we will get somewhere. And where compensation needs to be paid to some families of victims, compensation will be paid. So some of the victims who are alive and confident that compensation will be paid. And when we are talking about compensation too, there ought to be compensation for policemen who also lost their lives in the course of those protests. You know, policemen who are killed by hoodlums, not necessarily the NSAS protesters. Yes, among some of the NSAS protesters too, there were evil people who sat on social media abusing other people. We are not talking about those ones. We are talking about the sensible ones amongst them who genuinely wanted change. Those are the people that we are concerned about. We are not concerned about the hoodlums who hijacked the protest. We are not concerned about hoodlums, cyber hoodlums, who now used the opportunity of the protest to incite people against innocent Nigerians. Those are not the rule that we are talking about. But I believe that the president did the right thing by mandating the states to set up those panels so that at least in the various states we can see the extent of human rights abuses and then measures can be taken to address the problem.
Indeed. So Adewale, talking about the police and the armed forces now, there are concerns about human rights abuses. How can we get our armed forces now to respect the civil populace and stop rampant human rights abuses?
It's a whole lot of work. But what is most important to me is the training. We need to, the civil component of the training must be emphasized. You see, because the whole essence, even for soldiers, if you want to win a war, you need the support of your people. So if we have a military that consistently fights its own people, winning the war against external aggression would be very difficult. Mm. So I think the civil component of the training of Nigerian soldiers is very critical to, you know, addressing the kind of orientation that they have, so that they can understand that in whatever they are being paid from the tax of Nigerians, they are public servants. And when we are talking about people who offend them, the normal thing is that they should also not see themselves as being above the law. If you are attacked by somebody, I mean, there's a legal process. So I think the Nigerian military should realize that they need Nigerians in order to be able to sustain the military as an institution that defends the corporate extension of Nigeria. So I think the training aspect is very important. And this has to do with the instructors right from the elementary schools of military institutions. Mm.
And still on the matter of security now, the agitation for community policing in Nigeria gained more prominence in 2020 after the various parts of the country witnessed renewed security challenges. A sharp rise in kidnapping, armed robbery, banditry added to insurgency in the northeast. So, BKO, how would you rate the performance of the police under the following issues, talking about tackling cultism, banditry, armed robbery, and the likes? How would you rate the performance so far?
Well, I think that given the resources at their disposal, and when we're talking about resources, we're talking about equipment, we're talking about the weapons with which they can fight crimes of violence. I think the police have done well. It's easy to simply sit back and condemn the police, but you've got to bear in mind the limitations, the funding. Is the funding sufficient? The answer is no. We can do much better in terms of funding the police, in terms of equipping the police, than we are doing currently. So if we are unable to do that, if for any reason we are unable to fund the police sufficiently, then we should not expect the police to solve all of these problems. In Lagos, for example, there's a big problem of cultism now. And I know that that problem is being addressed by the police as well as the neighborhood watch itself, where we have a former AIG, Israel Ajao. They are doing a good job. But they still have a lot of work to do, because you go to places like Ikorodu, cultists have literally turned Ikorodu to their headquarters. They have to be brought to their knees. People need to be shown that, look, the state is superior to whatever their antics are. And it's the same approach that I want demonstrated against these bandits. Because bandits seem to think that they own Nigeria, and a lot of them are non-Nigerians. So there's no reason in the world to show any form of sympathy to them. They don't deserve to live amongst us. A lot of them are in the bush. That's where they ought to be. They are not human beings. So they should be given the treatment that animals deserve to be given. There should be no shred of sympathy. So people do not care about human lives.
Absolutely.
So once their locations are identified, send the helicopter gunships to go and serve justice to them. Because as I was discussing with a governor, said, well, if bandits come to my state, they are harassing me in my state, then I need to send a message to my great-grandfather through them. That means he's ready to kill them.
Yeah.
After all, they too are always ready to kill our people. They kidnap people, take ransom, and still take people's lives, even after they've collected ransom. And a lot of them are non-Nigerians. I've seen people who were victims who said they had them speaking foreign languages. Some of them were speaking Chadian language. Some of them clearly were from Niger Republic and Northern Cameroon. I know a policeman who was kidnapped who told me that the people who kidnapped him were from Northern Cameroon. But a lot of them will pose as like they are Nigerians. Mm. But a lot of them are not Nigerians. Their level of bestiality requires drastic action, comprehensive annihilation. That is what they deserve. So I would want the police to step up their fight against cultists, bandits, and armed robbers this year. How many APCs, for example, do the police have currently that are functional? How many? You go to some states, you see those APCs, they are disused. So why won't criminals escape? You need to get into the APCs, give yourself some protection while you go after the bandits. Well, a lot of them are disused. I've said it before, that if we equip the police sufficiently, give them APCs, sufficient number of APCs, they can do some of the things that we are telling the soldiers to go and do. They can do it. After all, the police went into one of the forests in Kaduna State, to go and dislodge bandits. They can do it, but they need the equipment. So I expect that in this year, the police will be better equipped so that they can execute their primary mandate. Because the way things are now, it's, soldiers are coming to do their work for them. If we give them all that they need, they get the right training, they get the right equipment, I trust you, there are at least 5 or 6 units within the police that can do get that job done.
Indeed. So, Adewale, with the points raised so far by BKO, what do you make of community policing? Do you think perhaps that's going to be the best way to go?
Yes, I think community policing is one of the solutions, a major one, to because every crime is local. We need to get local people to be involved in policing. We need to involve them critically because it's the environment that you know we are talking about. So they know the geography, they know the culture, they know the heritage, they know the language. Everyone, every community knows those criminals that operate in those areas. If they are foreigners and they come to those communities, if there are no collaborators, they will find it very difficult to operate. So community policing is the way to go. But then we need to understand what kind of community policing are we talking about. It's not the community police that reports to the IG in Abuja. It's a community police that is, you know, that reflects, you know, the global best practices. You know, where people, in terms of funding, in terms of management, in terms of organization.
So are you saying autonomy in this case?
No, you know, you cannot have true community policing that is under the IG. You know, that is why state police is tied in a way to community, to genuine community policing. But if you just still want to have community policing that the IG has to do the recruitment and everything, so it may be a long process, but we need to start somewhere. And like I've been saying here, it also involves some kind of constitutional reform, but we need to start. Whether it's going to take us 6 months, it's going to take us 7 months, but we need to do the right thing at the right time. We are a plural society and a federal society, and most federal states operate community policing so that communities can be, you know, the pathfinders in the search for stability, you know, and crime prevention. So there's no way we can do this without seeing a kind of radical, you know, restructuring of the Nigerian police, and that must necessarily, you know, involve community policing.
So BKO, as part of community policing now, 2020 we understand was a year of the Amotekun. The North Central governors also suggested the idea of a security outfit. Now, how successful can we get in terms of community policing?
Yes, Amotekun is, in my view, designed to assist the police in protecting us as a people. And it's trying to, it's an attempt to give us in another way, the state police that the, our constitution does not permit us to have, because the constitution says there shall be one police. So with community policing and community partnership in policing, we can at least achieve something by way of providing support, by way of synergy with the police. They will be working with the police, because there are many of our communities without police presence. No police post, no police presence at all. And these are the areas where these criminals thrive. These bandits that we are talking about, they hardly strike in urban centers. Mm. It is in the, rural areas, when people are driving through rural areas, that they go to kidnap people. Some even go into people's homes in rural areas and kidnap them. So Amotekun, for example, can be of tremendous value in this area, because they know the terrain, they know their forests very well, and they have the capacity to track criminals. So with that advantage, they can help the police a great deal. Look at civilian JTF in Borno State. Mm. Civilian JTF chased Boko Haram out of Maiduguri City. Mm. Because in those days, you could be gossiping even in your, in a taxi. saying evil things or saying some negative things, negative in inverted commas now, before they go and twist it, negative things about Boko Haram, mm-hmm. and they will come and get you in your house. So the civilian JTF, they knew them. They were going from house to house during Shettima's reign as governor. They were the ones who flushed them out of the city. If you remember, there was a time that President Jonathan came to Borno to have a town hall meeting. And some of the people who spoke at that town hall meeting were murdered. There was a time when workers who were building a building within the palace of the palace of the Shehu of Borno, and they were murdered. They were slaughtered because they were sleeping on site, and they were murdered. So because they were resident inside that place, and the boys knew them, so the boys went after them. They chased them. That was how they went into the forest. Today there is peace in Maiduguri. Is when you get outside Maiduguri that you could have problems. Was at least they've secured that area, and they are very valuable. Hisbah also does that to an extent in Kano, you know. So we need all of this, and the vigilantes and hunters, we need to use them a lot more. I can feel the efforts of the governor of Borno State when he's saying, look, we are going to buy den guns for our hunters and vigilante people, because he knows that in some of the villages where the Shekau faction of Boko Haram goes to burn people's houses, especially some villages near Chibok, for example. Mm. If you have a ready army of civilian JTF, they can confront them, because those ones are not as heavily harmed as the Abanawi faction of Boko Haram. Mm. So at least they can confront them, and they can provide information, and the soldiers can then come in and do the mop up operation. So this is the thing. I don't want to see an Amotekun that is an urban-based outfit.
Right.
I've said that before. That's not where they should be. It is outside of the state capital, like Ondo, for example. It is outside of the state capital that they are needed the most. How can kidnappers kill the Olufon with just five minutes left for him to get to his palace? Mm. He was already almost home. Hmm. I mean, it's rubbish to kill a first-class traditional ruler in that manner, you know? So there's a lot of work. When I traveled, I saw the Amotekun people on the road. It's a good thing. Even their presence gives you confidence as a traveler.
Yeah. Hmm.
That is what we want to see. Let other states take such measures.
You can
just let's have people protected. There's nothing wrong about that.
Hmm.
But they should not see themselves as alternative to the police.
Mm. Right.
You know, or believe that they are everything good, that the police does not constitute. No, they are not an alternative to the police. They are supposed to provide support for the police, work in synergy with the police. When they get hold of people they can't prosecute, they hand over to the police.
Indeed.
So that way, we'll be able to tackle crime in our communities.
In our community. Final words, Adewale, before we wrap up this show.
Well, Amotekun is a great thing. And I also traveled, I saw them. And I, you know, it gave me a kind of psychological confidence. So I think we should be encouraged. You know, I think it's a very good step in the right direction.
All right, and that's a fine place to leave it. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for bringing your thoughts to bear on the show. Adewale Adeoye. And as usual, Babajide Kolade Atitoju, it's a pleasure to have your thoughts, as always, on Journalist Hangout. And that's it for today's edition. Join us again tomorrow for another episode of our program. We are on YouTube at youtube.com/TBC News Nigeria. I'm Esther Mokwariola. Thank you very much for watching. Bye for now.